Yeah, it was the 4th of July last week, the week before the fest. Donnie come up to me, he was at my daddy's house, he was having a cookout like normal does. He said, "You mind speaking for me on the 15th? And you know, I'm always preaching to kids and stuff, you know, when God presents you with opportunity to serve, you say yes, you know. You don't say we're not creatures of no, we're creatures of yes. We should be saying yes to the Lord." And you know, so I said yes. You know, never thought about it. I said, "Yeah, I'll speak." And I thought about that thing later. I said, "That's the day after we get back from snowbird. What in the world was I thinking?" man, I'll tell you what, I'm tired, ain't the word. Like they said, we went on a hike Wednesday, and then I had a smart idea to go on another hike Friday. So me and my wife and Hunter and Al Michael went on another one Friday. We went even further than we did that the day before. And my legs, they sit here like this. I don't know if it's because I'm nervous or they just let fall out from under me. But if I fall asleep while I'm preaching, somebody just throw something in me and I'll try to pick back up where I left off. If you notice in the bulletin, you know, it says the lost generation. And my message is not really on the lost generation. It's just got a little bit to do with it. But, you know, just think about, you know, we've heard the term lost generation ever since World War II. You know, they've been using that for each generation, you know, since then. But really, like now, they're saying the millennials and the generations after millennials really like the lost generation, and I'm part of the millennial, by the way. I think if you're 18 to 33, you're a millennial. I think that's what you are. So if you're that age, that's what you are. And those under 18, I forget what they are, but they're saying they're going to be even worse than millennials. But the big topic now is the millennials. Everybody that you talk to is talking about millennials are going to do this, millennials are going to do that. They're the ones that you're going to see elected different presidents, different things like that, you know. But if you look at the facts about millennials and what they really go through, just a few of them is, you know, they have a higher rate in levels of depression, stress, suicide. They don't want to learn, they don't want to go to school. You have more dropouts from school. They don't want to work, or you know, at least they wait a whole lot longer in life to actually get a job. You know, most of the time, you know, generations before, you know, 14, 15 years old, you had a job and you worked, you know, at least during the summer, even earlier maybe. You know, but now you're 25, 28 before you get a job. You know, so, you know, that's just what you're looking at. And then on top of that, you know, 90% are dropping out of church when they get out of high school. You know, 90% of the millennials are dropping out of church. And so that's what, when you look at the millennials, that's what we got to work with here. You know, that's not a lot of good facts. You know, and you try to look up good things that they're doing, and most of it, you know, Christians really wouldn't consider that much of a good thing, you know, where they protest and they do this and they do that, but it's, what are they doing, you know, especially for the Lord, nothing, you know. And so I just want y'all to contemplate these figures and think about why is that, and we're going to read through some of these scriptures together. But if you look, you know, as y'all know, on Wednesday nights we've been going through the book of John, and we're in right at the point of Jesus' crucifixion. You know, he's been they've seen Pilate, and he's been flogged, and he's on his way to the cross. That's where we're at now in the book of John. But if you look back, all the way back to probably chapter 11, Jesus is talking about love God and love others. And all the way up to the point of his betrayal, which is in chapter 18. And you know, I was telling them, I said, from chapter 12 to the middle of chapter 18, really, is one night. That's only one night. You got that many chapters loaded into one night that Jesus was preaching to his disciples, trying to get every last little thing he could out of them to teach them because he knew he was fixing to be arrested in just a few hours. And so I mean, I don't know how much Jesus taught or exactly how many hours it was, but can you just imagine getting that much stuff in such a little period of time? You know, you got chapter 12, Jesus washed the disciples' feet, showing you how to serve, a servant attitude of the Lord. You got Jesus telling them, love one another, love God, love one another, love God. That's what he wants. He wants them to understand that. And so we're going to pick it up in John 17 in verse 20. Now the whole chapter of John 17 is Jesus' final prayer before he's arrested. So when he says amen here in this prayer, Jesus is being arrested. The crowds are coming together. But if we look through his prayer, this would be a separate subject, but if you were just to read this chapter, you would see just such a wonderful way to pray every day. You know, we got the Lord's Prayer, and that's another wonderful way to pray. This is a little bit different than the Lord's Prayer. And Jesus, I believe he did this to show the disciples how they should be praying on a daily basis. You know, if you look at the beginning of chapter 17, he's praying to God to have his will be done. You know, Jesus knew in just a few minutes he's going to be arrested. Lord, you have your will be done. You have glory and honor and everything is about to take place. You know, Jesus fixed to be killed. And then the second half, he prays for his disciples, his friends. He calls them his friends. You know, he said, Lord, keep them. Keep them close to you. Keep them away from Satan. You know, help them to love one another. And then the last part, he prays for the world. He said those that the disciples is fixing to go and preach to, that their ears and eyes and minds would be open to you, and that they would understand everything that they're saying, and that they too would become Christians. So we're going to pick it up here in the last, because this really just tells you what Jesus wants for you. Everybody, even Christians and non-Christians alike, this is what he wants for everybody. So we'll pick it up in verse 20. It says, I do not ask for these only, talking about the disciples, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. That's an awesome statement, if you really think about it. I want my children, brothers and sisters, us, to be one, just like Jesus and the Father are one. That's what he wants for us. Imagine what the world would be like if we lived that way. Just this unconditional love. You know, God said, Jesus, the only way we're going to fix the world problem, you're going to have to die. Jesus didn't hesitate. He didn't argue. He didn't say, what about this way or that way? He said, your will be done. Amen. You know, and if we had that same attitude towards others, toward each other, just think about it. How good that would be. If we keep on reading, it says, the glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I and them, and you and me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me, and love them even as you love me. All right, so he's going on and on. This is his desire for us. You know, he's talking here, he is talking about us. He's talking about everybody that's going to be, one day preached to and witnessed to and come to know him. You know, but before this, none of us, this was just the beginning of Christianity. You know, this was going to spark the movement that we do, that's what we're doing today. And, he was praying for his disciples as they go out and witness, that they would love the people they're witnessing to. And through that love, the people they're witnessing to would see Jesus. And they would understand and know that he is real and that he is from the Father, and they are one, and the disciples are one. And now, if I believe in this, I can be one with the disciples and one with God, and we can all live this good life. and perfect harmony. I mean, it really is. Here, and it could be here on earth if we would just do what Jesus is telling us to do here. It says, Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you love me before the foundations of the world. So now Jesus is telling you, now I desire for everybody to be with me one day in heaven. And he said he wants us to see the glory that he had before the foundations of the world, and before this world was even created. He wants us to partake in that. And seeing that he said just before that, you know, that God, you give me glory, and I have given them glory, talking about us. And so we're going to be able to partake in that same glory. We're going to have a glorified body just like Christ. You know, we're going to be glorified with him in heaven. You know, of course, we're going to be praising him. You know, he's going to be the one that we give all our glory to. But we're going to have that same glorified body. And we're going to be able to partake in that with Jesus if we believe. And this is his desire for us. This is what he wants for us. He wants each and every one of us to be in heaven with him one day. And it says, O righteous Father. And I love that statement right there. O righteous Father. You know, because if it had been us praying, we'd say, oh Lord, why are you going to send me to die? Because he's fixing to die. You know, Jesus is fixing to be healed in just a couple of hours. He's fixing to be arrested in just a few moments. And beaten and tortured in just a few moments. And he get old righteous Father. That's what he has to do. Even though he knows that all this is fixing to happen, old righteous Father. Even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know you, know that you have sent me. Talking about the disciples, they know that you sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. So he wants that same love that God has for the Son to be in us. We love each other in that same way. And he wants Jesus to, you know, Jesus wants himself to be in us through the Holy Spirit, and we'll be saved that way. So have y'all ever seen like a picture of what this might look like if we love one another this way? I think we have. And if we turn over to Acts chapter 2, I think these people had a love for one another that Jesus was praying for them here. We're starting on verse 42. It says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles, teaching in the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayer, and all came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together, breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Wow, what a picture. That perfect love that Jesus was talking about. Amen. I think that's what, I really honestly believe that this is what Jesus was praying for. And I believe that Jesus wanted this to continue on and on and on until his return. Yeah. You know, I think he wanted this to be going on today. You know, I mean, just think about it. Day by day, attending the temple together, breaking bread in homes, you know, eating together. And that also means, participating in the Lord's Supper together. You know, most of the time we say, you know, well, I'll give the Lord an hour. If I'm real good, I'll give him 2 hours. I go to Sunday school, you know. They went day by day, every day. And they worked too. I mean, nobody was without. The people that had would sell and give, and they had, and so everybody was just, you know, together in this wonderful fellowship, and nobody needed anything. Because if anybody ever did, it was taken care of. There was never no need. And they would go day by day to each other's houses, eat supper together, participate with the Lord in the Lord's Supper together, just spend wonderful time in fellowship, but also said they were praising God. Yeah, they were praising God day by day. I'm sure they were reading scriptures as well. That's probably part of them praising God. They were having Bible services, small group services, whatever you want to call it. And they were just loving on one another and loving on God. And that's what God's will for our lives is. Amen. And so you look at that and you say that the Lord added to that number day by day those who were being saved. And we see that around here, but I mean, just think about it. I mean, not only our church, but just churches, you know, just around here in this. Why do you think that is? You know, we're all the time praying for the Lord to move, and you know, we're going to hit on this a little bit this week as well. So why do you think the Lord don't move? That's right, I heard somebody say it. Sin. The root of all sin is what?
Selfishness.
That's exactly right. And so if the root is selfishness, you take it like a plant, the root is selfishness, the stem is what? The flower is what? It's selfishness. And selfishness is not loving one another, is it? That's loving self. And so I think that's the biggest problem we have in churches today. You know, I look around sometimes and I see, you know, like husband and wife cheating on one another. I see people up here doing different things, you know, over here maybe doing drugs, over here doing drinking all the time. And I see people over here that's, you know, doing pretty good, but they're not even witnessing. You know, I see people over here that they might stay at home all day, read the Bible, and pray all day long. That's it. You know, we're called more to do more than just that. And you know, and the sad part about that is that's people in the church. Not in this church. And in other churches. And that's what's wrong with church. That's why God is not moving. That's why the numbers are not being added day by day. Because the people that we're committing those sins with are out there. And they look in here and they say, I don't want to be a part of that. That's a joke. That's a lie. They're doing the same thing I'm doing. What do I need to go do that for? You know? And that's why God doesn't move. Unconfessed sin. And until we get our sins straight and start getting rid of this selfishness and loving on one another, it's not going to get any different. We might add a person here and there that's coming from such and such church or wherever, you know, but we want to add to the big church, the global church, God's church. You know, that's what we want to add to. We want to see souls being saved and lives being changed and people set on fire and those, you know, maybe going out and doing missions. And going over here and doing SOS, and going over here and helping Kahuna, and staying right here ministering to the young people. You know, remember what I tell you to be thinking about the lost generation, why are they like they are? Because we are like we are. And a lot of times we tell them, you know, well, you're good, and, you know, as long as you stay in church and do this, that, and the other, they're going to die and go to hell if they believe in this. And that's sad. I don't want to see anybody. I don't care who you are, die and go to hell. But I especially don't want to see any of these young people here in our church die and go to hell. Because of something we portrayed them that was not true. It's not in the scriptures. Let's turn back to John chapter 18. And this one really caught my attention. When we were talking about it in Wednesday night service. I went through it one Wednesday night and the next day the Lord revealed to me something about it, and so I shared with the youth the next night before I continued on. And so I want to share it with y'all as well. But we're starting chapter 18, verse 19. It says, the high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. So Jesus is now standing in front of Ananias on trial, and he's questioning about everything he's been teaching and saying to his disciples and those in the temple and those that's just been following him. And Jesus answered him, I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. And what he meant by this, nothing in secret that he hadn't said in public. You know, it's been the same everywhere. And he says, why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them, that they know what I said. So he said, you know, ask the others. Ask anybody that's ever heard me speak, and they'll tell you. Exact same thing I'm telling. And when he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand. And then when he struck Jesus with his hand, and it was like a slap, probably as hard as he could, to his face. Jesus, the creator of the world, the man that created him, the man that created Ananias, the man that created the things that's going on, that is standing there, the willing sacrifice. And he said, is that how you answer the high priest? Wow. I would hate to be that man. But this is what God revealed to me the next day. We are that man. Every day when we say no. Your plan is not my plan. Mm-hmm. Your will is not my will. Whatever that may be. Whether it's coming to church, loving one another, whatever. We say, who do you think you are talking to me that way? We slap him in his face. That is us. That is our nature.
Amen.
You know, when I was telling him that, you know, I hadn't thought about it that way until, like I said, until the next day. And I said, man, I got to share that, because that is powerful to know that we are that evil apart from Jesus and being his will. And, you know, after Jesus was hit, what did he do? He got back up, beat the mess out of him. You know, Jesus answered him, if I said something wrong, bear witness about the wrong, but if I said what is right, why do you strike me? You know, Jesus could have easily, and he'd have been no more, he wouldn't even exist in heaven or hell if he wanted to. He could have been never nothing, you know. But Jesus didn't do that. You know, and like I said, just for us to say that to the man that's created this world, the man that's created us, and wants what's best for us, he doesn't give us his will to make us miserable or make us do things we don't want to do. He does it because he knows this is what's best. He said, there is no better way. And yet we slap him in his face and tell him, who you think you are talking to me that way? I'm going to do what I want. That's why the kids are like they are. Because they see that in our lives. You might not think so, but they see it at home. They see it when you're away at work or off, whatever you're doing late at night or whatever. You know, they see it and they know. And they said this Christianity stuff is a joke. And that's why they are having high levels of depression, stress, and suicide, because they see no point in life. Because apart from God, there is no point in life. You can get all the education you want. Donna preached just a couple weeks ago to the graduating class. You can get all the education you want. You can get all the money you want, all the fame. Apart from God, it's vanity. It's nothing. It means nothing. It still leaves a hole inside of you that only God can fill. And so that's why it's important for us to examine ourselves and say, Lord, where am I falling short? Help me, Lord. Help me to love you. Help me to love one another. Confess your sins to him. Get down on your knees and confess. Think about what you've been doing in your life, and if there's something going on that ain't right, come up here and confess it. Lay it on this altar. And yet, nobody's going to judge you. If they do, they're doing wrong. You know, this is what this place is for. It's for you to come up here and get one-on-one with God and get right with him. And we as a loving church should huddle around you and pray for you and support you and lift you up and build you up and love you. That's what we're supposed to be doing. Like I said, this is what God laid on my heart. And I told him, I said, Lord, you might find somebody else to say this. I said, I ain't the right one. I said, God, I need to be saying this, somebody else. But I'm kind of glad he did in a way, because I love each and every one of y'all. I really do. And I want what's best for y'all, and God wants what's best for y'all. And I think this would be the best thing that we can do, is just to come down in this front, humble ourselves before him, and lay down our sins and leave them here. Or pick them back up when we leave. Go back out and do the same thing we've been doing. Leave them here. And let's gather around one another and love each other. And let's show this world what God is all about. Let's all stand with our heads bowed and our eyes closed.